Fanny Peculiar, written and read by Will Young. And introducing Will Young, he famously battled Simon Cowell 10 years ago and went on to win Pop Idol. It hasn't all been plain sailing, though. He also gets depression and he's here to sing his hit single, Jealousy. The lights fade up. I am singing on a late night show in Dublin. Really? I'm thinking. That is my introduction? I mean, I've had a few in my time, but I think this could be the winner. He's here to sing for you, but guess what? He gets depressed. He might even be depressed at this very moment, we just don't know. And people listen to the lyrics of the song, Jealousy. You must get very depressed to write these songs. Anyway, enjoy this one. It's upbeat, but the lyrical content is actually very depressing. I'm laughing inside, though, and luckily this is a rehearsal, so as I'm singing the song, trying to catch various camera angles, while perving on the mime band that has been hired for the evening, I decide I will ask if we can change the introduction. Either that, or we could just start the performance by swinging the cameras round to reveal me hanging from a noose. He gets depression. Look, it got the better of him. The back catalogue is out now, people. Faye, my day-to-day manager, comes up to me after the sound check. We've changed the introduction. Oh, great. Yes, we've changed it to, here is Will Young, who gets depression and is also on meths. Thought that would be better. Much better. Thank you, Faye. Faye smiles. Pleasure. The truth is that I do get depression. I suffer from extremely low self-esteem and a lack of confidence. In technical jargon, I carry shame. I am codependent. I suffer from love addiction and depression. In other words, I'm a psychotherapist's smorgasbord. It's bizarre because in one area of my life, my work, I'm as strong as an ox, and yet in another I can sometimes be as weak as a feather in the wind. I stress sometimes because it is getting better, and I certainly don't write this for pity. It is just a simple fact. If it wasn't for my singing, I'm not sure I would even be around today. Singing has been the one place where I've found my true, powerful self. The one place where I can express what I'm feeling and believe that I'm being heard. I feel wise in my singing. I feel wise in my career. I've had to deal with some tricky things in the 10 years since winning Pop Idol, but I took them in my stride. Actual real events, things that just happen in life, I can cope with these hardcore facts. I don't have to question them. I never see them as insurmountable. They're real and I know I will survive. It's what lies inside my head that has been hard to deal with. The inner dialogue of questioning and uncertainty. The tape that goes round and round, constantly jumping from one argument to another. It's like fighting a shadow or an enemy who keeps morphing into a new opponent. Standing on a stage in front of 60,000 people at the Diana tribute concert, singing a song that is challenging at the best of times, while doing a dance routine I've only just learnt, and negotiating speakers that have been left out by accident, that's a doddle. But standing there while in the back of my mind a voice is saying, you are the most useless piece of shit on this stage. No one is interested in this. Your boyfriend is sitting in the audience and he's so much better than you and is probably thinking, God, this is awful. You look fat. Your dancing is atrocious. This is the beginning of the end for your career. All of those disgusting thoughts and words come flying at me. Now they are much harder to take. By the time I appeared on Pop Idol, I'd already been through 3 years of depression, on and off. I remember standing in front of the judges and actually feeling protected by my experiences of sadness. They enveloped me like a cloak. I had been heartbroken, I had struggled and would continue to struggle with my sexuality. I had lost friends and experienced family hardship, and I had a degree in politics to boot. Anyway, this book isn't a rambling account of my day-to-day sadnesses, as riveting as that would be. It is an account of experiences in my life, both now and from my past. It came about through some happy accidents, and it's been fascinating not only to look back, but to discover how much I enjoy expressing myself through writing. Some of the stories are sad, some are hysterical, some are painful, and some are just the most wonderful things ever to happen in my life. Like the game Angry Birds on my iPhone. Simply life-changing. Chapter 1. Horrid Hell. This was the pet name of my prep school. Horrid Hell. Its real name was Horace Hill. I'd grown up knowing all about Horace Hill. Both my uncles had gone to school there. One of them had even been a teacher there for a while. And my grandfather had been a governor. In fact, my grandparents lived just on the edge of the school grounds, and the slate from their old house had been used on the school roof. In the summer months, we had the place largely to ourselves. I even learnt to swim in the school swimming pool. So Horrid Hell was very much woven into my life, and in particular life with my grandparents. I was 7 when I moved there from my previous school with Rupert, my twin brother. It had always been a boarding school, but that year they had accepted day boys for the first time. This meant you could arrive in time for chapel in the morning and leave before chapel in the evening. My sister Emma went to school up the road, so it was an easy run for my mum. We didn't board at first, largely for financial reasons. My father had just started a new business and the family couldn't afford to pay the fees. As it was, we had a deal with the school due to our family connections, 2 for the price of 1. I know a lot of people look back on their school days with real nostalgia, but I might as well come out and say it. From my point of view, when I was a pupil there, Horrid Hell was one of the sickest, most twisted and archaic educational institutions you could imagine. It provided me with many hysterical memories and funny tales of Billy Bunter-type hilarity, but it gave me no nurturing, no love, no warmth, and absolutely no preparation for anything pertaining to normal life. Looking back, it seems to me that quite a few of the staff, particularly the men, were emotionally repressed. Men who operated in a bubble. Some of the women were as cold as ice too, though I loved my piano teacher, Miss Waitley, and the matrons. Even the teacher's pets were cold and indifferent, providing no joy or love. And when I say pets, I literally mean their dogs, aloof, strange, emotionless animals. They would walk right past us, showing no interest in our attempts to stroke them. I was used to dogs that bounded up and licked you in the face and then charged off after a ball. But these dogs were impeccably behaved to the point of oddness. They stuck close to their masters and were completely indifferent to any of the boys. Trying to find a drop of love and kindness in this place was, for me, a lot of the time, like searching for life-giving water in the desert. I am forever grateful that I had such strong family links with Horrid Hell and that I had Rupert with me every step of the way. For if I hadn't, the place would have fucked me up for eternity. To be honest, it has done a pretty good job of that anyway, contributing to a lot of pain and suffering. Perhaps some old pupils from that time have other memories and would recount their experiences very differently. However, I'm certainly not the only one to feel as I do about it. I have run into a number of former pupils over the last 10 years who have shared similar stories. When I was living in Notting Hill, I bumped into a boy a few years younger than me in my local supermarket. He was quite handsome, actually. He had nothing but bad words to say about his school days. Another time I was at a party at the Serpentine Gallery and met a boy who was in the same year as me. He couldn't even bring himself to speak of his time there, to the point that he crossed the room to get away from me. On another occasion, Rupert and I were doing an interview together on Radio 5 Live about his charity, the Mood Foundation, which he had set up to help people with depression. A man rang in who was very complimentary about Rupert, saying he remembered him at school as a larger-than-life generous character. He then proceeded to tear apart the regime at Horrid Hell at the time. The list goes on. A friend of mine is seeing a boy who was a year or so below me. He says the same thing about the school. In all honesty, I have never heard a good word spoken about Horrid Hell around the time I was educated there. We had been forced to endure an institution that stifled any free thinking, leaving pupils feeling badly about themselves with no sense of how to be a happy young boy. I say boy because, of course, it was a single-sex school. Interaction with girls simply never occurred. I was 17 before I encountered girls within the education system. At this stage, I could rather neatly imply that if it wasn't for my prep school and my weekly watching of Dynasty at my grandparents' house, I would be a full-blooded heterosexual man. In fact, if it wasn't for Alexis Colby's shoulder pads and regular boys' showers, I might be shooting videos with beach babes rather than dancing with male mannequins in Iceland. That could be a whole chapter in itself, but alas, it's not true. Contrary to what many a priest and radical Christian scientist might argue, I was always destined to be a lover of men. As my grandmother once elegantly put it, "Well, you always said you wanted to be a ballet dancer." And there you have it. I can't nail Horrid Hell for my sexuality, but I sure as hell can get it for just about everything else. It was an impressive-looking school in impressive grounds. Every day we would turn off the main road, coming out of Newbury towards Winchester. I remember sitting in the back of my mum's Escort XR 3i with Lenny Kravitz or Terence Trent D'Arby playing on the stereo, and feeling the change in the vibrations of the car as we headed off the old A road and onto the smooth, noiseless tarmac of the long school drive that swept down past woods on the left and fields dotted with Shetland ponies on the right. As we levelled out into a mini valley, we would pass the junior football pitch, where I once imagined I was Black Beauty, and more fields overlooked by the school laundrette. The drive then curved up and forked, with one branch going to the private side and the headmaster's house, and the other leading to the main building. This road opened out into a large car park, surrounded by the swimming pool, four tennis courts, and the school sports hall, which also accommodated school concerts and plays. Along from that was the old gym and the squash courts. Beyond the main building was the school chapel and then a common, which was also a six-hole golf course and running track. If you stayed on this road, eventually you would reach the exit through some more woods, passing my grandparents' house along the way. So you certainly couldn't fault Horrid Hell on its facilities. I mean, we had two squash courts and a photo lab. The art school was brand new when I was there, and we even had an old printing room. The printing room was run by Mr. Brown. Now, Mr. Brown, I think, was one of the normal men. He was from Yorkshire, if I remember right. There was something rather endearing about him. He was a gentle-looking man, with quite a jowly, open, soft face, and everything he owned seemed to be from the late 70s, from his swimming trunks to his sunglasses to his car. He always wore a pair of baggy brown trousers, a knitted tie and soft black shoes. He ran all of the fun things at Horrid Hell, the model train track, which was amazing, the swimming pool and the school shop, as well as the printing room. The shop wasn't anything special, just a stationery cupboard by his desk, but Mr. Brown had every piece of stationery you could imagine. Because of all of his jobs, he would walk around with the most enormous set of keys jingling from a chain attached to his belt loops. Mr. Brown lived with Mrs. Brown in a house in the woods just down from the tennis courts. Now, Marianne Brown was a woman to behold. I'll never forget overhearing her say to my grandmother, who was known by all the teachers, "Margaret, you know I went to Camp Hobson's to get this scarf. I saw it, I tried it on, and really it goes to show. You pay for quality, Margaret. Feel that polyester, Margaret. Just feel it." "How lovely," my grandmother replied. Camp Hobson's was the local department store in Newbury and hadn't changed since the 1930s. It did a great range of padded coat hangers and Hoover bags and obviously a very nice scarf. But the way Mrs. Brown was talking, it could have been Hermes' flagship store in Paris. Mrs. Brown was a rather stern-looking character, I thought. Her face reminded me of an American eagle's. Her eyes, the way she moved, were bird-like too. She had long auburn hair, and like her husband, she was fond of a knit. Nothing was ever floaty. Her summer dresses were made of what looked like curtain material, and she always wore a sensible shoe or sandal. She was, in short, terrifying. So it was ironic that she had the task of looking after the first years. Every September at the start of the school year, these poor 7-year-old boys would walk into their new classroom to be confronted with this spindly, bony raptor of a woman who marched between the desks in her sandals. She would rap your knuckles with a ruler or slap you behind the legs if you did something wrong. Her favourite routine involved teaching the correct way to ask for something. It would go like this. "Young one, what do you want?" We were all called by our surnames, and any brothers were numbered. As I was the oldest by 10 minutes, I was young one, Rupert was young two. Why to God we were called by our surnames, I do not know. It was like working in a 1920s bank, age 7. "Young one, what do you want?"
Mrs. Brown, could I please borrow your pencil sharpener?"
"You could borrow my pencil sharpener," she would reply with relish. Oh, God, here we go.
Mrs. Brown, may I borrow your pencil sharpener?"
"You may borrow my pencil sharpener," the "may" being extended to "may" to allow full emphasis.
"Can I borrow your pencil sharpener?"
"You can borrow my pencil sharpener." "Will you let me borrow your pencil sharpener?"
"You silly bitch."
"I will let you borrow my pencil sharpener, young one. Come and get it," she would proclaim triumphantly with a tight-lipped smile. This felt like it happened every bloody lesson. I would sit there at my desk, running through how the conversation would go before I finally snapped and smacked her in the face. In my imagination, she was tied to her chair at her desk, with me and all the other children getting our own back on the old hawk.
Mrs. Brown, may I kick you in the shins?"
"You may kick me in the shins."
Oh, Mrs. Brown, could I wee on your feet, please? You could wee on my feet. Mrs. Brown, would you let... Oh, fuck it. Kapow! And with that, Mrs. Brown would be bazookaed off this earth. We could all run free and maybe even call each other by our sin of sins. First names. Hooray! Of course, this never happened. And all I ever learnt from Mrs. Brown was how to ask, in the oddest fashion, for a pencil sharpener. Another female teacher was Mrs. Wainwright Maxwell. Odd name, odd lady. She was actually quite pretty and had a softer demeanour than old Marianne Brown. Well, at least she may have appeared softer, but she was also as cold as ice, almost more frightening in a way. I would often see the teachers interact with each other or with the parents, and they would be all sweetness and light. But when they were in the classroom, this would change. It was as if they were almost conditioned not to show any love, joy, fun, sensitivity, or softness towards the boys. It's funny, because even as I say this, and I've gone through some really good therapy to get all of this shit out, I still feel some anger and sadness. Because all of these memories come from the experiences of my younger self. What I mean is, I must have known and felt their hypocrisy back then. And I did. I remember feeling outraged and perplexed by these odd people who were suddenly in charge of me. I had never seen anything like it. I don't want to give a character assassination of them. That would be pointless. But I do want to show my experience of the school and the people in it. So when I write about these people, I write from my truth. They could have been wonderful friends, partners, and family members out of school, but for the most part they were, from my perspective, shitty, shitty teachers. But not Mr. Brown. He was an interesting man, and as he ran many of the things I was interested in, our paths crossed a lot. He was also in charge of everything techie. If there was a problem, Mr. Brown would fix it. He could mend a light. He could rescue your frisbee from a tree. He was always doing something, and if you got in with him and became one of Brownie's boys, you were guaranteed some fun jobs. The printing room stood between the music block and the art department. I never discovered who decided that we should have access to a whopping great printing press, but it was so, and it was fantastic. With Mr. Brown at the helm, we learnt how to use the different fonts, Times New Roman, Times Bold, etc., and then how to assemble the individual letters into words, sentences, and paragraphs. Each letter was a raised mark at the end of a tiny lead block. You would put them together and hold them firmly in place with blocks of wood. These would then be squeezed by presses on either side. When you had everything in place, you would put it onto the machine, make sure your paper was in position, apply the ink onto the roller, and away you went. It was the best fun. There was something extremely satisfying about seeing this huge old printer bursting into life and words appearing on the paper, words that you had painstakingly crafted, letter by leaden letter. I would create headed letter-writing paper for home. In fact, anything that could have a heading did. The smell of the ink, the noise of the printer cranking away. It was brilliant. As well as making things up for fun, we printed out the Sunday service sheets every weekend, and bigger jobs such as the programmes for school concerts and plays. I rose up the ranks from junior printer, and by the end I was one of the few allowed to be left in charge of the printing room, along with my trusty band of friends, De Halpert, Castoro and Lewis. None of us really played sport, although I wasn't bad at football. So instead we helped Brownie with his jobs and basically got into trouble. We would rule the roost in the printing room, but there was another far more important reason why we spent so much time in there. It was the only place in the whole school where you could listen to music. Out loud. And listen to music we did. Michael Jackson, Peter Gabriel, Joni Mitchell, Debbie Harry, Prince, Stevie Wonder, Pink Floyd. In the printing room, we were free to dance around, to have fun. Free to enjoy ourselves. This was all so important because listening to music was pretty much banned at Horrid Hell. You were only allowed to listen to music for 2 hours on a Wednesday and Saturday and Sunday afternoon. All the other times your Walkman or stereo had to stay locked up in the stereo cupboard. I would get round this particular rule by hiding my Walkman in a plastic bag in the ceiling of one of the changing rooms. Then I would creep out into the woods and listen to Eurythmics, Lisa Stansfield, Joan Armatrading, The Beatles. Just like the printing room, this was my escape. A place where the teachers couldn't touch me. Hidden away in the woods, they couldn't control what I was hearing, or understanding, or thinking about. It was freedom. We were a funny group. Me, Rupert, De Halpert, surnames only, remember, Castoro and Lewis.
Castore was small and his dad was Italian. He was like the Danny DeVito of the playground. De Halpert was slightly taller, but he walked with a limp because one of his legs was shorter than the other. He'd had an operation which left him with an enormous scar running the length of one of his legs. When he ran, the limp turned into more of a hop. He was quieter than the rest of us and a little bit more accident-prone. Lewis was tall and very gentle and shy. He was also very funny. None of them was remotely sporty, and it was always fun to see the three of them move from their comfortable position of marauding the grounds as groundsmen, or working in the swimming pool, to attempting to kick a ball on a football pitch or trying to swing a cricket bat. Castoro in particular would defy anyone to laugh at him as he toe-punted another football onto the neighbouring pitch. We were all great friends, especially in the summer term, when we became the school's official groundsmen. The first job of the day was removing the swimming pool cover. The fun with this task was getting the chance to have a cheeky swim in the pool at the same time. This was a risky business because at any stage a passing teacher could simply pop his head over the fence and see any one of us paddling away or hanging on to the end of the pool cover while we were dragged along in the water by the others. We also had to incorporate enough time to dry our hair, otherwise the game was up. The other job that brought huge perks was delivering the cocoa. This wasn't the drink, but the name for the food and drink handed out to the whole school on half days, which were Wednesdays and Saturdays. It was normally ice buns or doughnuts, along with two or three large urns of orange squash. The first bonus was that we could go and collect the food and drink from the kitchens, which often meant we had a chance to carry out a quick raid of the biscuit barrels. These were all unmarked containers, stashed high up on a top shelf. Due to our height, we could only just manage to flip up the lids and scoop our hands into the barrel, so it was potluck what handful of biscuits we managed to grab. Our days were judged by our haul of biscuits. A good day, pink wafer, or my personal favourite, the nice biscuits. A bad day, plain digestives or a chocolate bauble. I was never a fan, I'm afraid. Somewhere in the middle, fig rolls. All this paled into insignificance, however, when we got our hands on the crates of iced buns or doughnuts that were entrusted to our charge. We would pile up the contents of our trolley and scoot off to the nearest corner, where we would sit for a while, gorging ourselves on the cakes and guzzling strong orange squash. The problem was that each doughnut or bun was counted out so that every boy would just get one. No more, no less. We would end up eating about four each, which meant that by the time we got up to the cricket pavilion, our stores were seriously depleted, and so again the boys in the first year were forced to eat digestives and keep their mouths shut. But then, one day, it all went horribly wrong. For some reason we decided to have a go at racing the trolley down the drive, which was very steep. It started off well, but the trolley quickly careered out of control. De Halpert went flying, the urns jumped ship along with the ice buns, and Lewis rolled into a patch of brambles. Castoro, unusually nimble, performed a cat-like leap and somersault and landed unscathed. I watched. The cocoa that afternoon was covered with grass and mud, and questions were asked. We were banned from using the trolley for quite a few weeks after that. One event that took in the cricket pavilion, the swimming pool, and most of the grounds, and occurred every summer term, was the parents' match. This was effectively our annual sports day. It was a tradition stretching back more than a century, with the main event being a match between the boys of the first 11 cricket team and their fathers. The day would start with athletics, then people would wander up to the main cricket ground, where the parents would park their cars around the pitch and get out their picnics. Like peacocks, they would arrive in their Bentleys or Range Rovers, Porsches or Ferraris, vintage cars or even the latest Rolls Royce. Wicker hampers would be laid out, some parents creating quite a display for all to see, with flower decorations and smoked salmon, while others hid meekly behind a sausage roll served out the back of a Morris Minor. De Halpert's parents would turn up in a modest estate car and park next to Mrs. Castoro, who would always be in a fluster over where she could park, had she bought the right food, etc. Lewis's parents would arrive, always very sweet and friendly. Finally, my own mum and dad would wander up with their picnic from my grandparents' house. I certainly had a sense of not being among the glamorous, rich families. Our little group was on the edge, really, operating in our own sphere, and that was okay by me. In fact, I wouldn't have had it any other way. With the family connection to the school, I guess I always felt pretty well protected in a way, and never really a part of the pomp and ceremony that can go on at these type of schools. Whatever was going on around the cricket pitch, whoever had turned up with the latest Panama hat or priciest barber jacket, the newest Mercedes or the best Filipino maid, all and sundry came crashing down to ground level and presented a united front at the highlight of the day, the diving competition. This was Mr. Brown's chance to shine. He was the ringmaster, the MC, the showman, the storyteller, the crusher of dreams and deliverer of lifelong desires. For Mr. Brown ran the swimming pool and, more importantly, he judged the diving competition. For the last 20 years at least, Mr. Brown had pulled on the same mustard yellow swimming shorts, there is photographic evidence in the Horrid Hell centenary book, stood opposite the springboard at the other end of the pool and set each contestant off on his planned dive. He would stand there in his shorts, hairy tummy hanging slightly over the waistband, soft, pudgy face pressed into a welcoming and encouraging smile. Mrs. Brown would not be far away, adorned in a flowery curtain number, watching her husband with fierce pride. Mr. Sudbury, Mr. Brown's trusted sidekick, was deputy judge. He would not wear trunks, preferring a grey woollen suit. God knows what he would have done if he had to jump in. He was a small man, tiny actually, with a little beard, and he would always be holding a biro between his hands. He taught French and also ran the modelling room. Rupert once came third in Mr. Sudbury's modelling competition. He was making a model aeroplane when it collapsed, so he painted a piece of wood to look like a runway, placed the mangled plane on top and entitled it Crashed. I thought it was one of the most genius things I'd ever seen. Mr. Sudbury was also in charge of the music for the school play and played the electric guitar. He was kind of cool, actually. Slowly as the time drew nearer to the diving competition, there would be a steady migration towards the pool. Some would walk and some would even drive, although the distance was only 500 yards or so. Such was the desperation to get a prime place on one of the benches around the pool. Some parents, particularly the fathers, would stay outside the compound and peer in over the fence. Meanwhile, I would put on my regulation swimming trunks along with the other boys and prepare myself, mentally and physically, for what lay ahead. There were three stages to this yearly event. First, a standing dive from the springboard. Second, a little run and jump, also from the springboard. Third, a dive from the high board. This was the one that held the jeopardy. This was the one that parents flocked to see. The first two dives were expertly curated by Mr. Brown from his position at the opposite end of the pool. He would stand there, clipboard in hand, as the diver waited for the signal. A little nod, and the dive would be performed. Then the second dive. Wait, nod, dive. Then Mr. Sudbury would take over for the third dive. Although parents would give the pretense that they were rushing to get the best spot for their own darling child, all of them knew that really this was a smokescreen, a lie. There was really only one boy that everyone had come to see. The boy in question was known for being the worst diver in the school. Every year he would participate, and every year his dives would be consistently awful. And when I say awful, this boy, let's call him Smith, never managed to get anywhere close to being vertical before entering the water. His body always remained crouched in a kind of arc and stayed like that as it smacked the water. He would fall like a stone every time. This is what the parents, especially the fathers, flocked to see, really. Smith's spectacular belly flops. Every year, Smith would stoically enter the diving competition, and every year, he held the entire school gripped. A silence descends on the compound as Smith prepares to take his first dive. And then the sound of 100 cameras being unzipped from out of their bags. Some mothers are muttering between themselves, and a father peering over the fence lights a cigar. Smith looks towards Mr. Brown. Mr. Brown nods and smiles. Smith launches himself from the board. Launch would be the wrong description, actually. He essentially falls straight down from the end of the board. A second later, his body hits the water, face, arms and tummy, all at the same time. Smack! The soft but unmistakable sound bounces gently around the pool. A little ooh comes out from the crowd. Smith resurfaces, defiant. In his head, this dive has gone well. Could this be his year? I don't think so, Smithy. I don't think so. There have been some impressive dives. One boy manages a perfect swallow dive with the run and jump. Another does a somersault. Bloody show off. I scrape through, my legs coming slightly over the vertical as I enter the water. I don't care. High tea is awaiting, and I have my eyes on the salami sandwiches. A family is congratulating the smug parents of the somersault boy when Smith takes to the board for his second dive. They stop mid-flow and turn back to the pool, eyes wide with anticipation. This time, Smith is standing right at the beginning of the board to give himself as much room as possible to run and spring. I repeat, to run and then spring. Silence descends again. Every year, one mother whispers to her neighbour, you'd think his parents would just take him home a day early. Smith looks for Brown. Brown finds Smith and gives him the nod, and Smith is off. He runs along the board and springs elegantly into the air. Could this be his year? Has he been practicing? Fathers are taking pictures frantically. Mothers are looking home.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.